Blitz A Ball, the fan.
What's up now?
Brother, what's up? This
is a deep recording, man.
Yeah, brother, dig it. Stop. Right on.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kiss.
I seem to be inept at everything except my work. I'm good at my work. So I confine myself to that. All I want out of life is a 30 share and a 20 rating.
The man's enlarged my mind. He's a poet, warrior in the classic sense. I'm a little man. He's a great man.
Think of it as colors. There's black and there's white. And in between is mostly gray. That's us. Now, gray is a tough color because it's not as simple as black and white. And for the media, certainly not as interesting. But it's who we are.
Fan Radio Network.
Did you see the game?
Sure did. And KFAN.com. 1 minute, 57 seconds past 3 o'clock Central Standard Time. We welcome you back to a very special Tuesday edition of the Bumper to Bumper program on a rather, it looks kind of overcast, but still incredibly balmy for this time of year, December Tuesday afternoon here in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. My name is Dan Barrero. I host the program. Guardsy out today. He's taking some holiday time this week. I'll be taking some holiday time largely next week. And we'll come together eventually. I think he's off tomorrow as well. Brett Blakemore, are you in that chair tomorrow too?
I think me and Max are flipping shifts tomorrow.
Oh, okay. So fair enough.
It's one of the two of us for sure.
So Blakemore's in. My name's Dan Barrero. I'm the host of the program, as I said, a longtime Inkstain Wretch. Newspaper of the Twin Cities, and we're delighted that you are part of tonight's festivities. I hope you'll stay with us from start to finish. It's another three-hour tour, and I will remind you that according to the Borton Volvo guest lineup, the updated version, we are expecting a visit with Vikings linebacker Jordan Hicks, fresh off by then what should be his first return to practice in weeks and weeks and weeks. He detailed the injury he was dealing with, compartment syndrome issue, and just how grateful he is to, first of all, not having to lose his leg, and beyond that, now have the opportunity perhaps to be a part of this football team before the season is done. So around 3:20, that's a little bit loose, but that's what we have been told. We expect a visit with him. Athletic, we now call him Johnny Apple, or maybe Johnny Apple Seed, in the wake of the news that The Athletic, New York Times, and Apple are all coming together. He will probably have details on that. And Johnny is now scheduled to join at 4:30 this afternoon. Louis is expected in studio for the 5 o'clock hour. And, of course, Louis fresh off induction into another Hall of Fame. This is a big one, too. This is the Italian-American Sports Hall of Fame. He was inducted, as we talked about late last week, on Friday night, alongside the former phenom quarterback for the Giants. Was it DeVito? His agent was being inducted as well, was part of that same class. And I think Louis might have a good yarn or two to spin regarding his own observations of said individual. So it's a power-packed three-hour tour today, and we are delighted that you are a part or intend to be a part of it. I'm looking at a headline that reads, is this the worst team in National Basketball Association history. And it's the story of the 2023-24 Detroit Pistons, one of the proudest franchises from NBA history. If you go back far enough, certainly to the Bad Boys days, they've had some other ups and lately lots of downs. And after losing Monday night in Atlanta, the Pistons have dropped 24 consecutive games. 24 in a row. Three more losses would give Detroit, the Pistons, a piece of history. In fact, it would be not a piece, it would be their history. With three more consecutive losses, they will become owners of the longest single season losing streak of all time. And beyond that, the Pistons entering the Monday game were on average losing by 12.1 points a game. Double digits. That, for the record, is the third worst differential in league history. Their overall record is 2-25. That means if they continue at this pace, they have a chance to break that all-time record for futility, which I think was Philadelphia 76ers 9-73, if I'm not mistaken. For the record, the 2013-14 Sixers dropped 26 in a row. They right now hold that record within a single season. Well, actually, they've tied with the 2010 Cleveland Cavaliers, who had also lost 26 straight. That was after LeBron James left in free agency. They have become the Detroit Pistons an open laughingstock. They are so bad, they have become good, or they have become worth people paying attention to. And you may ask yourself, why is Danny Downer opening the show, celebrating the ineptitude, the perhaps historic ineptitude of the Detroit Pistons, rather than celebrating what took place last night in Miami, Florida? Minnesota Timberwolves winning their 20th game of the season. Dramatic comeback from 17 points down to knock off the plucky Heat and Heat culture, led, among others, but mostly by Anthony Edwards offering up a virtuoso performance. And I'll tell you why I led with the Pistons rather than the Wolves. Because I've been here since the beginning of the Wolves franchise. I remember the day it was announced that Minnesota was going to get an NBA franchise. It's how far back I go. It's how old I am. And I've been around for the 16-game losing streak for the Timberwolves during the 2009-2010 season. Or the 16-game losing streak during the 1991-92 season. Or the 15-game losing streaks from 2014-15 during the 2010-11 season and the 2009-2010 season as well. I remember the 13-game losing streak suffered by the 2019-20 Timberwolves, not to be confused by a 13-game losing streak from the 2008-2009 Timberwolves. I remember a pair of 12-game losing streaks. I remember 11-game losing streaks. I remember 10-game losing streaks and 9-game losing streaks. I remember the times when people wondered whether the Wolves could set the all-time record for losing streak or consecutive losses in a row. And what I'm here to tell you is that we're not that team anymore. Trust your eyes. We're not the team that people are mocking and ridiculing and saying, well, how bad can it get? How do you explain it? That's embarrassing. That's awful. That was us. That has been us way too many times. That's not us anymore. Trust your eyes. Trust what you saw last night in, for me, as riveting a regular season NBA game as I can remember in some time. I'm not sure you could watch the next 10 years and see a better regular season game. For competitiveness, for drama, for shot making by both teams down the stretch. Now, finally, we can look and point at somebody else, some other city, some other franchise, and say, that used to be us, but it's not. God, does it feel good to not be the center of ridicule? Better than that, is it not good to see a team that this season especially, we saw it all kind of come together last night, is playing harder, smarter, and better. A team that relishes the fight. May not win every game and won't win every game, but is not backing down from the fight. Not curling up in the fetal position. The first moment it looks like this isn't going to be our night because it didn't look like it was going to be their night last night. And also with the talent to make something happen in the fight. Because fighting's good, or the ability to fight back is good, and tenacity is good. But if you have limited resources, it's only going to take you so far. The Pistons were us, but we're not them anymore. And I do think, because I know how the psychosis in this town works when it comes to sports, there are people screaming at their radio dials right now saying, don't do this. You're setting us up for the grand failure. You're setting us up for raising our hopes and dreams only to see them scattered and dashed on the rocks. Well, I'm here to tell you, I can't guarantee that eventually you're not going to be disappointed. But I am also here to tell you that this isn't your sister's Timberwolves team. It's not your daddy's Timberwolves team. It's not your granddaddy's Timberwolves team. They are different. May not lead to a banner, but they are legitimate. You saw it also last night on just the what we call in the business the 50-50 plays. There was a great sequence late. Rudy makes a great block in the lane. Then there's a loose ball. And it's 50-50 between buckets. Jimmy Butler and Anthony Edwards. And Anthony Edwards said, you're not going to get the ball. I'm going to get the ball. Got it. Took off. Ended in a slam dunk. This isn't like revolutionary if you got a franchise that knows what it's doing and has had a measure of success. But here it is revolutionary. And so we've got this stark contrast going on. Oddly, our fans probably could relate more to what Detroit Pistons fans are going through because that's been our history. But it ain't our history at this point. History is being rewritten or is being updated is the better term because what happened, happened. There's not any way to change that fact. But I think it should be okay, in my opinion. You do not have to apologize for celebrating the difference with a capital D from what was then losing streak after losing streak and maybe chasing the wrong kind of history and no longer being that team that's mocked and ridiculed, a team that is actually gaining measure of respect pretty much every place they go to this point. It's okay to celebrate it. You don't have to apologize for it. Doesn't mean anybody here is guaranteeing that the Wolves will be raising a banner by the end of the season. It's about what we see in front of us. And if you couldn't see that again last night, a more serious team, what I've asked for forever, be serious. Just be a serious team. go out and act as if you mean to be in the fight and you mean to do something about the fight. And that is what I saw last night after the extremely slow start. We will not have a problem celebrating that.
On iHeartRadio.
Follow the fan this football season and on Twitter and Instagram. You could win $100 in gas money thanks to your local Chevy dealers. One winner chosen every single Friday. It's brought to you by your select Heartland Chevy dealers. Find new roads.
The power pack, Bort and Volvo guest lineup will include Louie in the five, Johnny Athletic at about 4:30, and we hope Jordan Hicks. We're at the mercy of the Vikings practice schedule, and we had hoped to get him right about now, but if we do, we'll let you know. Otherwise, perhaps even, we got a little time. That's the beauty of Johnny not being on until 4:30, if indeed we can get Hicksy sometime later. He was supposed to be practicing at least in part this very afternoon as well. Bradshaw and Bryant KFAN text line has been rebooted. It is 64686 if you'd like to join the conversation. It's interesting because I'm not sure the young fans can appreciate all of that opening monologue. I think they might appreciate some of it, but the fact of the matter is, in more recent years, the Wolves have not been hideous. They've been up, they've been down, mainly down, but not historically down like they were earlier. But for the people who've been around for a while, they're feeling it. They know what I'm talking about. Being the team that you go, oh, God, it's like, how bad can it get? That has to be the most refreshing part of this thing, that we are definitely in different territory. Indeed, Jordan Hicks, kind enough to join us via the Kinetico Water Systems Hotline, weekly contributor to the program. And Jordan, my sources say today was supposed to be your first day back at practice. Can you confirm it? And if that's true, how did it go today? How did it feel to be back out there?
It is confirmed. And man, I'm sitting here still in my spiders and, you know, all the clothes I just wore, man. I feel good sweating again, freaking getting out here and just going. It's about, man, it's about time. It's felt like forever. So it feels good, obviously.
Well, and again, you sound like somebody who's reminded that you can't take it for granted. You know, we all do. That's how life works. It's human nature. But when you've been through what you were through, then it all comes back to you. It's like, no, this is pretty cool. I want to keep this thing going. Because you never do know when it might be taken away from you.
Yeah, yeah. And that's, you know, that's definitely my message, especially in the situation we're in right now. Obviously, you know, if we've got to handle business, no secret about it. And each day has to be the most important day, right? And so I think those two things go hand in hand. You have the right perspective. You understand that it's a gift to be out here. It's a blessing to be out here. There are people that wish they could be out here that aren't, that didn't make it, right? We have an opportunity that a lot of people wish they had. So, yeah, it's special.
So tell me how much you were allowed to do today. Are you going full? Are you going 50? Do they have like a special sort of, all right, we still got to be cautious in a process to get you to ramp you up? How is that working so far?
Full go, baby.
Full go.
We did all ramp up these past couple weeks when I was feeling like I could go.
Right.
You know, my body's been pushed. Obviously, there's going to be a difference between being out there talking and running gassers and doing different things on the field by myself. But we've tried to push it as much as possible. So today was a full go.
Outstanding. And nothing hurt. You feel well, maybe other than your wind. I'm guessing you're still probably getting your wind back. But nothing.
Wind's actually pretty good.
Really?
The trainers don't have the best concept of rep count and rest time.
Right.
They were flying through. They've got a number that they've got in their head, and they attack it in about 45 minutes. So wind is feeling good, body's feeling good, shin is feeling good. I'm ready to go.
Excellent. Outstanding. Well, part of then what I think we should also talk about is I got to believe the conversation within the defensive meeting rooms is, look, the numbers speak for themselves. We've spent a lot of time talking about them on this show the last few weeks. A team that was ranked, I believe you guys were ranked 30th last year in points allowed per game. You were fifth. You made a huge, you guys made obviously a huge jump. The one thing that has hurt recently, and it kind of came to fruition, especially in this last game, was fourth quarter. That you're giving up some points there, and in that case, it was 21 points, which I know you don't think is acceptable. I know no one on this defense thinks it's acceptable. So, is there a thread that you can go to say, all right, here's where we have to get better, or here's how we can make adjustments? Why it's happening that defenses that are playing really well, much better, is finding itself more vulnerable in the fourth quarter?
Yeah, you know, it's hard to pinpoint, actually. It's one of those things where collectively, coaches, players, we've just all got to be better, right? We've got to execute better. We've got to have better communication, right? The games come down to those one or two possessions, you know, that change the game. And so we've got to be better in those scenarios. Each call has to feel like the call that's going to change it. And, you know, It's hard to pinpoint one thing. There's a collection of plays that kind of spiral and snowball. Yeah. But there's opportunities out there, right? You see opportunities out there to change the game, and we've got to take advantage of them when they show.
Which sometimes means takeaways, right? And which you guys have been doing a really, really good job of. You know, it becomes a little easier to give up yardage if you can end the drive and give the ball back to the offense, right, to just make the kind of play you're talking about, whether it's forcing a fumble or grabbing an interception.
Yeah, turnovers are really the key of the game. You give your offense another opportunity, right, and change momentum, especially on away games like Cincinnati where, you know, it's tight.
Yep.
The fans are engaged. Everything is just kind of stacked up against you, right? You've got to find ways to change the momentum. But a lot of it is just execution, right, and guys – being in position, but just finishing plays. And, you know, that's the difference between a game, you know, pulling that game out and not.
Yeah, very, very true. So you know what the situation is. You're sitting at 7-7 with three games left to go, all now within the division, obviously. Detroit this week, Green Bay in between, and then against Detroit there as well. How do you feel about this team's position when it comes to, obviously, the goal is making the postseason? You're being asked to do it. Well, you've started like four different quarterbacks, which is unprecedented. But how do you feel about this? The team's position, where you guys are, and the ability to try to finish this thing off and make the postseason?
Yeah, I mean the focus is got to be it has to be one day at a time, you know, and one game at a time. We've got to handle our own business. We can't look outside. We can't look at everybody else, other divisions, other games that are going on. We've got to make sure we're 100% locked in what we're doing day in and day out. So, you know, it really is playoff football already. We understand that. We feel that. And, you know, again, it's one game at a time. We've got to attack.
So in terms of how quickly you might be able to actually play, what do you know, or what do coaches tell you, or is it a matter of you having to prove to the coaches that, yeah, I'm ready, I'm back, I have not missed a beat, I'm back in that position? What's the process there?
Yeah, I think there definitely is a feeling out. I think they have to, in their heads, they've got to know that I'm ready, that when I get out there, right, I'm not putting myself in jeopardy, I'm not putting our defense in jeopardy, right? But I've got 100% confidence in where I'm at, right? So there's a process, and I've got to still check off some boxes. But,
right.
You know, again, it's just like the rest of this whole situation. I've been feeling good. I'm ahead of schedule, and things are optimistic.
Is it unrealistic to think that you could actually participate this Sunday, Christmas Eve?
No, not unrealistic at all.
Yeah. You're going at it like you're going after this thing, and you're not going to give them any reason to doubt your ability to be a part of, to contribute.
That's it. I mean, my thought process has been the same ever since, you know, they designated me on IR. It was get back as fast as possible and attack, you know, like I've been saying, we've got to do now as a team. We attack every day, right? That's been my mindset for the past month. And so, you know, if that is including this weekend and attacking this weekend on Sunday, right? That's my plan. That's been my goal this whole time.
You want the green dot back too, right?
whatever role they've got me at, right? We've got to navigate this whole situation. It's still Tuesday, but
sure.
Yeah, you know, we've been playing good defense. We'll see how it all shakes out.
Well, you sound good for sure. The Lions, as you know, they're an interesting club offensively in that when they do the things they do well, which is largely not turn a ball over, they can be as explosive as anybody and as balanced as anybody. When they turn it over, which had happened for several games before this most recent dominant performance, then they're far more beatable. What are your observations from afar, because this will be the first time you'll see the Lions up close this season, of their offense and the QB Goff?
Yeah, I mean, it runs through him. Obviously, their running game is very dynamic as well. Offensive line is extremely strong. You know, backs are explosive. But, you know, when Goff is in rhythm and he's slinging it, right, it's a hard bunch to stop. So we understand that, you know, and we've got to find ways to create turnovers. Just you know, how we've done, how kind of the formula's been this entire year, finding ways to make plays. So, yeah, got to disrupt that. Got to make way to, you know, find a way to get him out of rhythm.
Do you have an opinion? You know, there's been a lot of discussion about the tush push and whether the league should consider the idea of outlawing it, whether it's a bad play or it's an unfair play or whatever. As a defensive player, do you have an opinion on the whole tush-push discussion?
Oh, man. That's it's hard because nobody's really, truly been able to replicate it.
Right.
Right?
That's true.
You know, you look around the league and teams trying to run it that are getting stopped and can't do it the same way as the Eagles are. It's hard to say. I know people are getting hurt. Quarterbacks are getting hurt, yeah, in terms of quarterback sneak, right? There's an element of that. Guys diving at people's ankles and knees and different stuff. There's an element of that. But, you know, if an offense is willing to put their quarterback at risk in that sense, I don't know. It's kind of intriguing, because you want to see a defense figure it out, right?
Yeah,
and we've yet
right
to do that.
Yeah, that's to me the kind of the comeback is, well, don't be mad that the Eagles do it well and take it away. Figure, you know, something out. I mean, and try to, you know, improve upon it of how the Eagles have done it. On the other hand, I've always kind of wondered, like, you're in this position where we now, I think we see this down the field a lot more than we used to, where a running back, you know, gets 3 yards and then two offensive linemen come from behind and knock him forward another 5. And I know that's always been kind of a part of football, but I feel like we're seeing it a little bit more. Well, you're a defensive player. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, to me, that's part of the game in terms of downfield.
Right.
If an offensive lineman is going to be running, you know, 3, 4, 5 yards chasing the ball, right, that's hustle, right? If it's the defensive line is going to try and knock him back.
Sure.
And that's an element of hustle. But in terms of tush-push, man, you watched the game last night. You see Bobby Wagner jumping over every single time and just surfing over the sea of bodies, right?
Right.
As a linebacker, that is, you know, you try to figure out a way. How do you defend it as a linebacker? I have no clue. Try to push back, but big guy's back there.
Last item, we're chatting with Jordan Hicks, fresh off his first day back at practice. What, I don't know how much direct communication you have on a daily basis with B-Flow, for example, but if you have some, what do you guys talk about? What does he tell you? What is his expectation for you?
Yeah, you know, we haven't talked much in terms of expectation. It's more been broad picture of defense, yep, and, you know, where we're at. And, you know, at the end of the day, we're playing good defense. We just got to play better defense, right? Be a dominant group if, you know, we're in these situations.
I got to believe your teammates had to been pumped to see out there, though, right? What kind of reaction did you get on the field?
Yeah, it was good. It was good to be back out here. Everybody's, you know, saying the same thing. Glad to see you. Glad to have you back out here. You know, there's nothing like playing football. That's the reason why you're out here. Be with the guys, to play, have fun. You enjoy running around, making plays, and, you know, it's what I thrive doing.
I think you may have seen, maybe you haven't seen the stat. We were talking about it earlier in the week. In this season, 2000, from a TV rating standpoint, 72 of the top 75 rated TV shows are NFL games. It's still, I mean, honestly, every time you think, well, it's gotten too big or it can't get any bigger, that's how popular your favorite game, the game you're relishing getting back into, is. It's remarkable.
Push that market cap up. That's great for the sport.
That's true. It's it. Thanks again, man. I'm glad you got back out there. Good luck this week, and we'll be in touch.
Thanks, Dan. Appreciate it.
Always a pleasure. That is the Vikings linebacker, Jordan Hicks, obviously pumped to get back on the field. And I'm not surprised that he's pushing. He wants to play this week. Now, whether that's realistic, who knows? But you can sense that he's a guy who, as a veteran player, has a new appreciation for the game he plays. And when you factor in what he's been through, how bad it looked early, how cautious everybody had to be with that compartment syndrome issue, you can. It's not difficult to sense that there's a bounce in his voice and a bounce to his step as well. And really, as we talked about with him, that's the key issue that the Vikings have to try to resolve these last three games, is the defense finishing stronger. Overall, no arguing with the improvement over the season, but the fourth quarter issues, especially as it played out this last game, giving up 21 points, that has to change. We all know lots of games, especially close games, are won in quarter number four, correct? So he's going to, he hopefully will be maybe part of that solution. If not this week, maybe the week after. I got to believe his leadership would be helpful. Maybe he gets the green dot back, and that also can be helpful as well. But that's part of the story that remains to be told for these last 3 weeks for the Vikings. Reminder that Johnny Athletic's going to join us at 4:30 today. Louie is scheduled in studio as well. A couple of texts have come into the Bradshaw and Bryant KFAN text line. Want to hear about a Vikings team that can win. I'm giving up on the Vikes losing all these teams. We should have won even with a backup to Cousins. So sad and disappointing. Endless turnovers. Well, it's not difficult to ascertain that if you're going to play a second or third level quarterback, your best chance to survive is going to be defense plays well, defense finishes strong, and offense just simply doesn't turn the ball over. There have been two or three games this year where I've said, literally, if the Vikings don't turn the ball over, they're going to win the game, even if their offense is not particularly impressive. But the turnover bugaboo was a huge issue early. They seemed to rectify it in that stretch where they got back in the race, and then we're seeing it again extensively now. And as I mentioned yesterday with Kevin Seifert, Mullins, and this is the double-edged sword of it, Mullins is not afraid to make mistakes. And to a certain extent, you can't have a quarterback so paralyzed by fear of making a mistake that they don't try to make any plays. On the other hand, there are times where discretion is the greater form of valor, and you worry that given his history, which is throwing one touchdown for every one, or one interception for every one touchdown he throws, is going to get in the way of this team having its best chance to finish with probably needing, what, two victories? I think most people think that they're going to win two. Although, again, Seattle won last night, which puts them also at 7-7. I think we're still ahead of them in the standings if the season were to end today. And I know we've got the lead, I think, on a couple teams, the tiebreaker. But now, see, even that could start to change because the rest of the season we're playing finally back in the NFC. So a lot of these tiebreakers are conference tiebreakers. So if we keep losing, then maybe we even put ourselves in the bad position there. On the other hand, too, is for tiebreakers to matter, you have to be in a tie in terms of your record. And that means you can't keep losing ball games. So I'm guessing Our position is pretty good if the Vikings win two out of three. It's obviously great. If they win three out of three, I got to believe in that sense, into getting into the playoffs, the Vikings would control their own destiny. If you go 10-7, you're going to be in. To somehow steal the division, that's pretty simple. You got to sweep the Lions, and the Lions have to lose to Dallas, which is not impossible because I think that game is there. But it may well be, I think it's a bit of a tall order to think they're going to be able to sweep the Lions, given the issues that they continue to deal with at the quarterback position as well. One other quick text I wanted to get to. I'm shocked to learn that there are actually three TV programs that are as good as any NFL game. I don't know anybody who watches network TV anymore. It's horrible. That's Darcy from Maple Plain. Well, there ain't a lot that I love on what would be called network TV. But there are, and we know pro football has always been very popular, but, that particular stat struck me as, being pretty dramatic and pretty remarkable that 70, because I don't know that there've been 72 great National Football League games this year. Maybe there have been, but it's a reminder that they don't really even have to be great. Look, there's bowl games that are going to get, the college bowl games are going to get decent ratings because people love football. They like pro better than college, but they like college a lot better than a lot of other programming as well. Let's pause here. Don't forget, as I mentioned, Johnny coming up at 4:30, and I got some Timberwolves text to get to.
Bumper on the Fan.
Check out the Friday Football Feast this week at Buffalo Wild Wings in Apple Valley. Doors open at 8 ahead of a live 9 or noon broadcast with PA in charge. Join us for football, wings, and prizes. Full list of dates and locations, KFAN.com. Keyword calendar.
You say that your love was just for me, that I got to be yours.
Kind of a potpourri of subjects to take us to the top of the hour, both in and outside the toy department. A couple folks are, I think, fairly noting that some of the NFL ratings dominance this year has to do with the fact that there, you know, there was relatively little new programming because of the writer's strike. That's true to an extent, though it's not going out on much of a limb to say that many years NFL games dominate like really no other single entity is able to dominate. Andrew writing, the Timberwolves coverage on KFAN has come at a perfect time. I live in rural Minnesota. Now I've got a way to listen to the radio call. Alan Horton is fantastic. Team brings it every night. They seem to have blue-collar attitude. Do you think there's a chance that this isn't sustainable? Could they burn out in Jan/Feb? I'll ask Johnny Athletic that very question at 4:30 this evening. I will also remind you that tomorrow night's game against the Sixers in Philly is on the flagship, FM 100.3 The Fan, but all games are indeed on the Timberwolves channel. I listened to it on the way home yesterday, and it is very easy, especially depending on where you are. You don't have to worry about what frequency do I need to find them in on that sort of thing. Like back in the old days, you hit the app, the iHeart Radio app, and just search for the Timberwolves channel, and it's there for you. Not to mention lots of other programming, Wolves-related, lots of interviews that we've done on our show and that have been done on several other programs as well. Also worth noting that in the second half of the ball game last night, the Wolves allowed 42 points. The defense was quite good. 6 turnovers forced, 5 blocks, 4 steals. Butler, by the way, buckets was 1 for 3, I should say 1 for 5, and had only 3 points. Tyler Hero, who'd started strong, 8 points. Gobert, once again, was magnificent defensively at key times. And the through the final 25-37 of that game, the Wolves outscored Miami by 21. They were down 17, which was the makes this 17-point comeback the largest of the season as well. I'm hearing from a couple people, including Mark Rosen's cat, Willow. According to Johnny's employer, the New York Times, if the Vikings win 2 of 3, not sweep, but just win 2 of their last 3, they have a 99% chance to make the playoffs. I'm always leery of some of those stats, but I will try to take this one at its word. Obviously, if they win all three, they're in. But if two of three is that is even higher than I might have imagined, if you care about the analytics as well. You know, we talked, ranted, frankly, last Friday about the plea deal that was ultimately accepted in this case in the killing of a 39-year-old paralegal from Plymouth named Stephen Markey. This involved the second shooter involved in this particular case. Hussein Braveheart was the second shooter. And ultimately, the moral of the story is that Braveheart was going to get no more prison time. He was basically going to be out on prison serve 4 years. It is worth noting there was an update in that story as of, I believe, yesterday. Maybe even been earlier today, because there were a couple of other cases he was involved in. And they have to do with two cases of armed robbery. And in those cases, he's been sentenced to 365 days at the Hennepin County Workhouse after his attorneys and prosecutors reached a plea deal for the two robberies, which happened just 2 days before the deadly carjacking that killed 39-year-old Stephen Markey. Not a real surprise that that's the approach that Hennepin County Attorney's Office would be taking. That's the approach that they've chosen to take. I find it reprehensible, rippable, and we laid out all the reasons for that late last week. But the reason I want to get back to it is I happened to hear our guy Joe Friedberg was on with my former partner Chad a couple of days ago. And Chad asked him about this particular case. And what's you got to remember about Joe, has actually been in the wake of a lot of Mary Moriarty criticism. Friedberg has tended to defend her or believe that she deserves the opportunity to sort of play out what she pledged was going to be her approach as a Hennepin County attorney. So I was going to be very curious to see how he felt about this particular deal. Remember, the earlier plea deal, the judge rejected. And then this time around, the judge accepted a plea deal with no more prison time because he claimed that a change in really what Braveheart was charged with. They took away a second-degree aid to murder charge, turned it into something else, and the judge claimed that because of that change, he had limited options, even if he expressed qualms with accepting the deal he had. What I found interesting was Joe said, bad decision by Moriarty to make the change in the first place. I trust him more as a guy who has been kind of in her corner. To me, that kind of stood out. And secondly, he told me something else I had not understood. He said the judge was not obligated to accept that plea deal. In his mind, the judge still would have had a right to say, I'm not satisfied with this. Go back to the drawing board. Figure something else out. But that he believes the judge wrongly took himself off the hook, almost like, well, nothing I can do. They changed that charge. They took away that second-degree charge, murder, aiding murder charge, and therefore I was left with no choice. In Joe's esteemed opinion, there was a choice, and the choice was to reject that deal just like he rejected the first. So the moral of the story, as far as he's concerned, is he gives Moriarty an F as a letter grade, but he gives the judge an F or a D as well as also being complicit in something that as the last arbiter, the guy who still has the power to make the decisions, made the decision he did, even as the judge admitted he did not feel real good about doing so. So as I said Friday, this isn't just about, for me, one case. This is the latest example, but there are several cases. We've cited from several of those cases, which to me tell me that Mary Moriarty is not serious about justice in the way that even in the balancing of justice, in a way that I think serves this community. And it's interesting to hear Joe Friedberg, a defender of Mary Moriarty, say in this case that he actually agrees. Let's make this the top of the hour pause. We'll come back and talk about a subject so controversial that I hesitate to bring it up, but I'm going to right around the corner. Don't forget Johnny. Do we call him Johnny Apple now? Johnny Paywall, former AP sports guy. He's going to join at 4:30, and Louie in studio